OECD Observatory for Public Sector Innovation, we do three things, because I'm going to start with introducing it. We share, which means people, the government, we ask governments, what do you think the innovations in your governments are? And please send them to us. So they send us their innovations, which can be everything. It can be in financial, it can be in procurement, it can be in many things. And they're often also in this field, so how to involve citizens better, how to work with citizens. So that's what we do first. We get them together, put them in a database, and we plan in the next year to share them. I will show the database a bit later. We use it to inspire, because governments always search for better solutions to the problems they have. They all face similar problems, and they all search for new ways of solving these problems. So we thought, as the OECD, why not make this platform so people can learn from each other and also make sure that they get in touch with each other, learn each other's lessons, and not just read the thing, but also talk with each other and learn. Then promote. We want governments to innovate more in different fields, so we do research on why do some governments innovate in certain fields, why do others not? Which forces are the driving ones, and which things are important in a government to incorporate to make them more innovative? Well, this is what it's about. This is our. It will go live within a year. We now have 100 innovations from our pilot study, and we will start gathering more from February. And it has a lot of options. Looks very nice. I'm very proud of it. It's new, the design and stuff. So it's a database, but it's also a community. Make sure that people can talk to each other, find each other's addresses, and with us as a mediator, make sure that innovations are not only shared but and read like a book, but also used to build a network of people who are on the same themes, who are with the same problems. So you can compare different innovations with each other, and you can not only see how they were built, so what methodology was used to get them in the government, also what did it cost, what were the problems you encountered, and what did it bring you? All these things we try to bring together in this database. Well, I think I'm going to go on. This is the tweet I was asked to give. Innovation, a small step for society, a big step for a government. That's something we often believe. We think that the public sector is very innovative. They do a very lot of things. They're really driven by a lot of things. They want to make a profit, so they will come up with new stuff. But when we look at the facts, we see that governments are. They are busy implementing new stuff. They are busy researching and piloting new options. And of course, sometimes it's difficult, because all the things we know, the bureaucracy doesn't make it always make it easier, the hierarchy doesn't always make it simple, politics can get in the way, but still, sometimes drivers on service level, people who are in contact with the citizens, will come up with new solutions, and they will find their way up. Like a police officer in the Netherlands who thought, the way we deal with lost documents is really not very interesting, it's not very efficient, let's do it differently. Led to a new law which makes it possible no longer to visit the police station and just handle it with your local office. It was a police officer who came up with that. These things happen. So we think that's why I wanted to show some innovations, because I think governments are innovating, and sometimes bottom-up is a very good thing, but it's not the only thing. And sometimes, especially here, we all have bottom-up things, so let's talk about top-down. Here, this is one from Brazil. And it's wonderful, I think. These are all women. They're all from rural areas in Brazil, especially from communities where there's a lot of violence, a lot of drugs, abuse of women. And these all are women selected because they have, at least they can read, all of them can read. That was the minimum requirement on education. And furthermore, they all have a good contact in their society. They have contact with youth, and they are trained here on basic human rights. What are human rights? What are normal circumstances? And they are trained as conflict mediators. And the government thought, well, we can send in police officers. Doesn't really work in these neighborhoods. So they went there, they selected the women, and they trained them. And now in those neighborhoods, when there is violence or when a conflict is happening, these women, they jump in, and they act as conflict mediators. And they're just women who live in this neighborhood, and they were empowered by the government, not only by knowledge and training, but also by giving them sort of position in society to do that. Everyone knows they're conflict mediators, and it's very effective. These women were empowered by the government to make a change in their own society. And there's Vienna, it's very different. Switzerland, let's go from the one world to the other. It's the Wiener Charta. I'm not very good at German, sorry for that. They thought, well, civil rights and how we live as neighbors, neighborhood, is not something we can put into law. We cannot say to you, be nice to your neighbor, and if you don't, I will come and pick you up and give you a fine. You can't do that. You can't make it a law. So how do we promote neighborhoods to work together and live together and exchange their opinions? And they just started a platform. And in this platform, it was not only, they said, well, you can, what do you want to talk about in your neighborhood? And what do you think is important subjects in these talks? And who do we need to get together? And it ended up with, I'm going to get my little paper here. They got 8,500 people involved, talking about their community. Together, more than 12,000 hours of volunteer work to talk about how do you live as neighbors. They, all the districts were part of this, and it just made a whole movement of people in one city talking about how do I want to be a neighbor to the others. And it was very top-down, but especially because the government was so aware that we can't do this. We cannot make a better society. The society has to do it themselves. It really showed, and people did turn up, and it was noticeable. And then there's one, another one. It's from Iceland. And the police there, they said, well, there are things we can do and things we cannot do. It's very hard to communicate sometimes. And, well, the only time we communicate with people is when we pick them up and say they're doing something wrong. And it's not really a nice relationship. Because, well, all the time they see us, something must be wrong. There's a police officer here. So what they did, they went online. And this is their Facebook page. Look. 4.5. This is, I think, 1/4 of the Icelandic population. It's 44,000 people liked this page. And when there was a big storm, within 30 minutes, 10% of the population had all the news available to them because they just went to the Facebook page. And that's a way of communicating. It's not the only thing they do, because they also have an Instagram with 6,000 followers where they put regular pictures on what they're doing in the day. They have Twitter where they communicate with, I think, also 5,000 people follow them on Twitter. But also, they have regular talks on the internet. They have topic discussions with people. Also, they just ask questions like, we need to enforce traffic regulations. Where do you think we should do that? Have a talk about that online, getting Twitter in, and then do it. So they not only used it as a communicating tool, they understood that our basis as a police is in a society. So where we should return is a society, and we will just ask them, where do you want us to go? And we will go. And that's, again, when the government is feeling that thing that we are not here to rule you. We are the only way we can be is with our feet in society, because that's where we came from, and that's where the knowledge is. I think that is one of the strongest drivers for innovation as well. And for me, being here in this wonderful arena, is I've been reading innovations on paper, and I see it in practice here, and it's beautiful to see how many things are happening. And I think it's wonderful that I have a lot of bottom-up initiatives, but I feel that especially the link when it comes together, when the bottom-up comes together with the top-down, and when the government sees, well, even if we are the top, we have to look down and see where we come from, and even that's where our strength is, that's where we touch the earth. I think then the beautiful things happen, like the three initiatives I talked to you about. And that's where I want to end it.